On this journey, I get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. And my story isn't over, my story's just begun. And failure won't define me, 'cause that's what my father does. Yeah, fail, you won't define me, 'cause that's what my father does.
Ooh,
lay your burdens down.
Ooh,
here in the Father's house, check your shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore.
Ooh,
you're in the Father's house. Arrival's not the end game, the journey is where you are. Never wanted perfect, you just wanted my heart. And the story isn't over if the story isn't good. And failure's never final when the Father's in the room. And failure's never final when the Father's in the room.
My veins, my dead heart began to thought would never end. Trying to make it on faith in a struggle against the wind. I've seen the dark and the broken places. Oh, but I know in my soul, no matter how bad it gets, I'll be alright. There's hope in front of me. There's a light I still see. The storm you finally find, where the hurt and the tears and the pain don't fall behind. You open up your eyes and up ahead there's a big sun shining. Right then and there you realize you'll be
so much for joining us this morning. I'm Josh, and this is Rabbit Creek's online campus. As hopefully you have already noticed, take a moment, share it on your Facebook feed, take and share it on your YouTube. Help people be able to connect with the way that you're able to connect through the body of Christ at Rabbit Creek. It's awesome to worship. It's awesome to worship with you. And so let's get that started with the song, Fill This Place.
It's a light that burns in the darkness. Fear away. There is a hope that washes the fear away. There is a peace that settles around us. It is your love that sets our hearts ablaze. Father, we're on our knees with every heartbeat away. This offering, Lord, come and fill this place. Father, we're crying now. Spirit, we need you now. Glorious love surrounds us. Lord, come and fill this place. Search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise, treasures of faith, never enough. But you came along and put me back together. Is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you. I'm not afraid. Show you Put your morning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. Into gardens, you turn bones into armies, you turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who from wherever you've been, come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, oh sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burden. Those who stray, you sit at the table, come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't cure. So lay down your burden. Be still. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens. Lay down your shame. All who are broken, up your face. your heart to come as you are. Come as you are. Come as you
Hello, Rabbit Creek family. I am Lori Pepitone. I get to be the children's pastor here at our Hillside campus. And it is my privilege to get to worship with you through speaking, through bringing the sermon today. So let's open very quickly with just a word of prayer. Thanks. Father God, we thank you for today. We thank you for all of the life that it holds. God, we ask that you would continue to be in this moment, that you would speak into our hearts and into our minds, Father, and I ask that you would help each one of us to be open to you, to receive what you have to teach us today. God, help us to be open to you, to listen, because we know that we speak and we know that you're trying to move all the time, and sometimes we just don't pay attention. So God, I ask that we be open. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So this morning, I get to continue Pastor Mark's sermon through series through Ezekiel. And I have chapter 18, verses 21 through 24. And let me just preface this with, these were not the easy verses. Okay? So I'm going to read them, and then I'll share with you how this went down. Let's start. Ezekiel chapter 18, verse 21. But if a wicked person turns away from all the sins they have committed and keeps all of my decrees and does what is just and right, that person will surely live. They will not die. None of the offenses they have committed will be remembered against them. Because of the righteous things they have done, they will live. Do I take any pleasure in the death of the wicked? Declares the Sovereign Lord. Rather, am I not pleased when they turn from their ways and they live? But if a righteous person turns from their righteousness and commits sin and does the same detestable things the wicked person does, will they live? None of the righteous things that person has done will be remembered. Because of the unfaithfulness they are guilty of, and because of the sins they have committed, they will die. So, yeah, those are the verses that Pastor Mark left for me. And I didn't think that was very nice, because there's a couple of main points in these verses, right? And actually, the one that perhaps a lot of people stick with or get stuck on is not my issue. I actually don't have a problem with a person who leads a horrific life and in their deathbed moment proclaims faith in the salvation of our Lord Jesus Christ. I have no issue with that person being given eternal life. But I do have an issue with Ezekiel and I guess with God, because Ezekiel was speaking God's words, right? And he's saying, but if a righteous person comes to the end of their life and they have stepped probably slowly away from a life of following me, then they will have eternal death, separation from God. And I went, hiccup right there. And I called Robin on the phone. That's Mark's admin. She's fabulous. And I said, Robin, I'm going to need a minute with Mark. And she goes, all right, coming up. And I go up and I had my Bible under my arm and I'm hoofing it up to his office. And I hear her holler over his shoulder, Mark, she's got her Bible under her arm. And he goes, all right, I'm ready. And so I went in and I went, Mark, really? And I said, we need to make sure we're on the same page here because I'm preaching. And I like to have, just make sure, right? And I went, Mark, this is Old Testament. Ezekiel is Old Testament, Old Covenant, Old Promise. We live in the New Testament world. We live in relationship through Jesus Christ. So let me just make sure here, we don't think this anymore. I said, when you become a believer, you have the gift of salvation forever. Because we all fail. He goes, yeah, we're on the same page. I said, whew, thank goodness. Now, I just shared with that right now with y'all because that's a sticking point. And we're going to come back to that later, but I know if you're like me, and I had said already, hey, there's something I had issue with, and then I didn't tell you what it was, you would pay no attention to anything else. So you're welcome. So this sermon leads me, man, it led me on some serious rabbit trails. And the one I ended up on for the longest was this concept of righteousness. I'm a little passionate. You probably can tell, maybe, I don't know. But I care about how things are done. I'm an Enneagram 1. If you haven't gone down that particular rabbit hole in the last few years to know what Enneagram stuff is, then God bless you and keep you. But I'm an Enneagram 1. So for those of you who know, and those who don't, that means I have some perfectionist tendencies. And that does not come for me in the form of trying to get things perfect, like OCD, everything needs to be just right. Nope. For me, it comes through things being done the correct way. And for me particularly, that's regarding social justice through my life in Christ. That means things need to be done in such a way that they are God-honoring. So the rules that we follow, the rules that are created, I like rules. I like things to be, you do this, this is what happens, this is the way everybody does it, and the world gets along just fine. But I like the rules to be right. That may make nothing to you. It means a lot to me. The difference in a rule for the sake of a rule and the rule for right, for the best for humankind, for the best for people, to be considerate. And so for me, the concept of righteousness is really, really difficult. Because I have always, when I'm reading in the Old Testament, the Psalms, and somebody says, well, I am a righteous man. And I'm like, whoa, back it up. Because I am not righteous. I know very well how often I screw everything up. I yell. I'm critical. I'm judgmental. I mess up all day long, every day. Lori Donnell Guillory Pepitone is not a righteous individual. And so it always catches me when somebody in the Bible is like, I'm a righteous man, I follow your decrees, I do this and that. Because in Deuteronomy 6, it says very clearly, God says, in order to be found righteous, you must follow all of my decrees, all of my laws, all of my commandments, all of the time. And And God did us the, I think, really generous favor of including in Scripture all of the, well, not all of the stories, several of the stories, the instances when these very people messed up big time. Like, selling your wife twice wasn't an accident. That was bad. I don't really think that was righteous behavior. And then if you go to the New Testament, because you're like, well, we live in the New Testament world, Romans 3:23 is very clear. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, the righteousness of God, the holiness of God. We're not it. So where does it leave us? The Old Testament had hundreds of laws that the people had to obey, had to keep in order to show God that they believed in him. And in Genesis it says, Abram was found righteous because of his belief. And the New Testament refers to some of these same individuals and says they were found righteous because of their faith, not because of their action. The law existed to show humankind they weren't good enough. We weren't good enough. We were never going to be able to get it right enough. Because frankly, right enough means all of the time. So Jesus comes onto earth in his human form. And before he dies on the cross, he has this conversation. And he says, friends, three rules. I'm fulfilling all of the law. My perfection will take care of that. But I'm leaving you with three instructions. And this is he's having this conversation and somebody says, what's the most important, right? And so he says, love God with all of you. Love you with all of you. And love people with all of you. And I kind of giggle when I say that, because it was a few years ago when I was teaching our elementary service, and we were teaching that particular passage, and I said, God, or Jesus came and he told us, you know, he fulfilled all of the law, and he left us two overarching rules. And I was so thankful, because it's way easier to remember two than hundreds. And I said, he said to love God and love people. And I was reading the full passage to them, and I said, you know, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. And one of the kids goes, Miss Lori, you missed one. Like, what? Yeah, you missed one. You have to love yourself. You can't love your neighbor if you don't love you. I love learning from your kids. So now, it's three. Love God. Love you, love people. And Jesus left us those three, not because they're easier than following the minutia of what you have to wear and what you can eat and how far you can walk and what days and all of that. In fact, these are even more encompassing, because this is living the love of God all day, every day. Our footsteps should squish out the love of God wherever we walk. The footprints we leave behind us should be love. And I don't know about you, but that is not easier for me. So Jesus comes, and this is what he gives us. This is what he says he expects from us. This is righteousness is what's required for eternal life. And I'm not. Let's go to Romans chapter 3, verse 21 through 26. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. So this is talking about the Old Testament, all of the Old Testament, the law, the prophets, everything that happened there was pointing toward the Messiah and showing you the holiness, the righteousness of God. And it says the righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference between Jew and Gentile, from God's chosen people, the Jews, to everybody else in the world. For all, does not matter who you or your mama is, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. None are righteous. And all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith. He did this to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance, his patience, he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. Centuries of sin that the people, his chosen people, had offered sacrifice for. They had striven to follow all of the rules because they were doing that to show, God, I believe you. God, I believe you're sending a Messiah who will save us. He says, I didn't punish them. They did not experience eternal death because they believed in what would happen in the future. He did it to demonstrate his righteousness, God's righteousness at the present time, right then, so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. God did not want death or eternal separation from himself for anyone. No one. Previously in Ezekiel, in chapter 11, he even is prophesying through Ezekiel, and he's telling him, tell the people, tell my children, yeah, they're in exile right now, but there is hope for a future in which I am going to take their hearts of stone. They're stubborn, unyielding, whiny, complaining, selfish hearts. And I'm going to give them a heart of flesh that is gentle and malleable and soft and listens and surrenders to my will and will follow me because they understand that I love them more than anything in this world. We can flip back to the New Testament in John chapter 10. And Jesus says, the thief, our enemy, Satan, he comes to steal and kill and destroy. But I come so that they may have life. And not just skimpy little life. They have it to the full. That's what Jesus comes for. He comes not because we are righteous. I am not righteous. But Jesus is righteous. And because Jesus is righteous, he has shared that with me. And God sees me through Jesus. This is how we have this life. Go back to Ezekiel, where we were at the very beginning. Ezekiel 18:21. He says, but if a wicked person turns away from all the sins they've committed and keeps my decrees and does what is just and right, that person will surely live. They will not die. They will not have that eternal separation from God. I love the way Peterson says it in the Message. That same verse, the last part. That person, he'll live. Really live. He won't die. This is the best part. I will not keep a list of all of the things he did wrong. He will live. I could tell you in any given day how often I messed up. God doesn't do that. He doesn't do that. Life is available through Jesus, and God doesn't see me the way I see me. He sees me as his precious daughter in whom he delights through the blood of Jesus Christ, whom he looks and he smiles. And he goes, look at my amazing daughter. Do you have this life? It's there for you. It is the one decision. We talk about this in Kidmen all the time. This is the one decision that you have to make for yourself. It doesn't matter if your spouse wants this for you, or your spouse adamantly doesn't want this for you, or what your parents or your grandparents believed. It doesn't matter what your friends believe. It doesn't matter what your children believe or want you to believe. It matters what decision, what choice you have made in your own brain and your own heart. Have you admitted that you sin? You are not righteous. You make choices that are against God's holiness all of the time. Have you chosen to believe that Jesus Christ is the living Son of Almighty God, that he gave up heaven, came to earth to live as an ordinary kid in an ordinary family? He went to an ordinary school and learned an ordinary job. He had ordinary chores and homework to do. And he lived all the way through that till he was 30 and he went to do his public ministry ordinarily. Except not. He never sinned. He never had a behavior that was unrighteous. And if you choose to believe that that is true, and you choose to believe that in his ordinariness, he chose to take the sin of all humankind onto himself, chose. For the love of you, for the love of me, for the love of humankind, to die, because the consequences of sin is death, eternal separation from God, because God is righteous and humans are not. But Jesus was. Jesus is. So Jesus could take all of our sin onto himself and be the sacrifice that covered all of us. It's there. He wants you to accept it, but you have to choose it for yourself. Declare to him, God, please forgive me. And Father, I want you to be in charge of me. Be my Lord. Help me to follow you. Help me to exude your love through everything I say, everything I do. And sometimes that means we give up our personal rights for the sake of others. Sometimes it means we sacrifice money, time, energy, whatever it is. I will do what you want me to do, God, because you are my Lord and you love me the best. And I trust you. Does it mean as a Christian, as a Christ follower, that you are now going to live perfectly, righteously. I already told you I'm not. I sin regularly, but I am forgiven. And God sees me through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. He declares me righteous. So let's go to John 10, a little further down than we were before, and go back to that very first sticking point I had. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one. And so when we choose to yield our lives to God, and he gives us the ability to have this abundant life, the Holy Spirit moves in immediately. And now you have access to the Spirit to give you the power, to give you everything that you need to have that abundant life when you walk in the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. That is what I want squishing from my footsteps in my everyday, ordinary, new or old life. If this is a choice that you need to make, please make it today. Please make it today. Declare Jesus is your Lord. Accept his gift of forgiveness, his gift of salvation, so he can declare you righteous and you can begin your abundant life. Friends, if this is a choice you need to make today, please do. You can email me at Lori@rabbitcreekchurch.com. You can email any of our pastors. We would so love the privilege of getting to talk with you through this time. Thank you for allowing me to worship with you today.
Good morning, Rabbit Creek Church. Thank you for joining us on our online campus, whether you be Facebook or YouTube. We're so happy to have you here. If you notice, it's not morning for us. Somebody turned out the lights, and we also have somebody who you know very well, but we don't get to hang out with very often. We have Dr. Mark T. Goodman.
Hey, folks.
And we're at Men's Retreat right now.
Yeah.
So we just wanted to bring him on here so he could tell you about giving, and we wanted to show you guys how Men's Retreat is going. We got the fire in the background. Inside, we got guys playing card games and playing guitar. And so we had a special message on giving from you, right?
That's right.
So what can you tell us about giving?
So what's exciting is during this COVID time, lots of churches are trying to ask the question, how are we going to make it? Our people are not there as much, and sometimes people are worried about finances. And we're just so thankful to all of you who are participating, because here at Rabbit Creek, we have been able to continue to pay for our ministries and missions and really encourage folks with the funds that God has given us. And we just want to thank you. And if you're not plugged into that yet, encourage you to 97,000 give RCC and just keep going, because this is a wonderful way to continue to serve. So thank you so much. God's doing great things because you are praying, going, and because you're giving.
We have an amazing church family. Indeed. Now, we mentioned the 97,000 number. We can also mention our Church Center app. We bring it up every week, and I'm going to go ahead and flash that icon on your screen right over here. I'm in a different angle, so I don't actually know where it's at.
It'll pop up somewhere.
It's somewhere on this side of the screen. But Jonathan, we got other ways that we can be up to date with Rabbit Creek Church.
Absolutely. So, as always, you can follow us on our Facebook page, our Instagram page, and even our YouTube channel. We throw up our videos up there. You can watch our previous sermons from our Hillside campus and from our online campus on the YouTube channel. So it's a great way to keep up to date with anything Rabbit Creek Church.
Right.
And that is always the best way to stay up to date with Rabbit Creek Church, whether you be
Hillside campus,
Huffman campus,
or online campus. And we love you oh so much. We're going to head out of here. We're going to get back to the fun that we're having at Men's Retreat. And before we do that, we're going to flash up our pastoral staff. If you would like to get a hold of them throughout the week, feel free to use those numbers. And also, thank you, Pastor Lori, for that amazing message. I got to personally watch it a couple times. I know you guys haven't gotten to watch it yet.
Look forward to it.
But it was phenomenal. So, from all of us at Rabbit Creek Church, we love you.
We miss you.
And we can't wait to see you soon. Bye.
Bye.